Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Summit 2 by G2Way.com Europe. And we are in day number 13 of the Europe division. And for our second matchup of the day, we got six best of ones for you. It's going to be Navi taking on Moscow 5. And Navi recently coming back from their Ukrainian trip to, of course, Star Ladder and having mild success. Gods, I'm trying to remember, refresh my memory. They made it their way into the winners, I believe, but ultimately fell short.
They lost all their playoffs matches.
I believe they were playing, what, EG, I think?
In the first round, they played against... EG got second in that group, I believe, didn't they?
Radiant team.
Man, you're asking the wrong guy. I was stuck casting while I had to sleep through Star Ladder, unfortunately. But I know they had...
EG got first. Tinker got second.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so EG, yeah, they lost to EG, and then the lower bracket, they lost to Cloud9.
All right, so they're coming back from fair performance.
They took a game off Cloud9, so it was a 2-1 loss in the lower bracket.
10 seconds.
You know, and surprisingly, they made it to play. I guess that's a good thing. They didn't party too hard, apparently, as Star Ladder just came to a close yesterday. And they're already back in fighting shape and ready to Dota it out some more. Currently, though, if you were just curious, their standings right now in the Summit 2 Europe, they're sporting a very nice 3-1 record. Pretty respectable nonetheless. Moscow 5, 3-4. So they desperately are clenching onto some wins. They're trying to get themselves into an opportunity for at least some tiebreakers. While Navi are sitting pretty right now, feeling pretty confident, would love to be able to secure themselves a spot in those playoffs. And well, as we get things underway, as far as draft goes here, Navi, they're going to pick up the Skywrath Mage Batrider combo. That Batrider, of course, being one of Funnic's bread and butter kind of a heroes, being able to find and isolate some big plays. And Moscow 5, it's going to be Mirana, followed up with the Watermelon Man, the Tidehunter.
Okay. Yeah, Tide, kind of the new flavor, I guess, after Star Ladder in some ways. But having these offlane heroes or these initiators who are also super powerful late game. Tide's great because, sure, even people will go BKB against you, but you get to late game enough, people have 5-second BKBs, you can bait out the BKBs, then go in with Blink Ravage afterwards. Like, you don't have to get Ravage right at the start to win the fight because your teammates are tanky enough, they can just kite your opponents around during those BKBs. We saw Secret using lots of 4-staffs, and Batrider's a similar thing. Late game, he's still a beast because of the pick-off potential that Maso gives you.
I am nervous, though. A Batrider going against the Tide always just kind of rubs me the wrong way. And then at your point, your Batrider is kind of always second-guessing. I mean, we touched on it briefly last game, but it's just like whenever a Tide's in the fog, you're just kind of second-guessing what kind of commitment you can make. You jump in, you get a hold of, let's say, just the Mirana, for example. He'll be right there with more likely a Blink Dagger ready to go, and your whole engagement just kind of turns up on its head. And then next thing you know, you're going to be more on the defensive trying to get away, and it can be rough.
It's definitely not. I think once you get your full stuff, it's okay. Like, I don't think Tide counters you that hard then because you force away. So if Tide's in range to Blink Ravage after you full stuff back into your team, then, I mean, he should have been getting spotted because that means he was pretty close to the target you jumped on anyways. So once you have your full stuff, it's generally slightly better.
Yeah, but then it comes down to quick fingers. Who's got the quick reactions to try to make the plays happen to get on in there? And a follow-up Shadow Shaman pick, which is something we don't see of too much as of recent. It's been more in its heyday in the previous patch when the Dire had the much more significant Roche advantage. You maybe would see him lingering, especially on the Dire side, to get some quick Roche takedowns with the benefit of those wards. Remaining. But they were tweaked a bit, and they have now quickly become free gold for most teams to kind of farm up. Now, so far, Navi don't have a tremendous amount of range, but I wouldn't put it past them to consider something crazy like a sniper grab at this point to kind of just pelt down easy wards. But we'll have to see how they work it from here. And also just kind of moving back to the beginning, one of the notes I saw that Bulbud pointed out during Star Ladder was the Mirana grab, especially as a support on the Radiant side, being able to have much easier arrow setups. It just seems like Dire in the mid lane especially, they're kind of always second guessing, and they're in a worse position for arrows to be coming in from a Radiant side Mirana.
That's actually, it's one of those things you don't really think about when drafting, I think, right? Like, at least most captains, but...
When you're secret with Puppy,
as soon as, like, you mentioned that Bulba said that, I'm just like, when I've played support Mirana in pub games, it's so easy on the Radiant side.
Yeah.
Because You go on that plateau above mid lane, and even if they know you're on that plateau, like, you can swing basically around between the T1 and T2 mid and fire an arrow from behind.
Anywhere.
Like, while you're still in fog. Or you can go, like, the far left. Or you can go below. Like, there's actually...
Yeah. Whereas if you're the mid on the Radiant side, you, with just a, any sort of respectable ward, you would know exactly if there's going to be Mirana pushing behind your enemy lines, maybe going for the courier and hitting you from that angle. But
once you're there, you're like, if you're a level 1 Mirana with arrow, you die. They come for you, you've got no leap, you're kind of dead. But on the
So they might need to consider someone elusive. And I wouldn't put it past them to put something like a Puck in the mid lane that can just avoid any sort of early harassment
Radiant
coming their way.
Ban.
I mean, we'll have to see, though. But they're waiting for it. They usually like to nurse it to the back end, then they do something surprising. And it wasn't that long ago that I got to see, like, Dendi of old come out. They pulled out a TA, and he must have brought in, like, 46 denies. He put on a mid lane clinic, and it was just, like, the classic. Like, now, you know, you see a lot more cores in the mid lane, or like Death Prophets and Dragon Knights and Razors, and you kind of miss the heroes of old where it was more like the Pucks, the TAs, these flashy heroes, you know, that someone like Deadly, Queen of Pain, you know, Mushi's Queen of Pain and stuff, where you have to see these heroes just put on like a serious exhibition. But it was nice to see that kind of thing, and it's something they could consider, because now with the Slark grab on Moscow, it's clear that they also are going for more snowball, not more like tried and true late game, like a Morphling or the Naga or the Terrorblade, something like that. They're looking to get the job done mid game and not push it too far and just banking on some huge snowball factor.
Navi actually going to run a safe lane farming Doom, it looks like, with the...
It's a lot of beefiness, melee, and, you know, it's interesting.
They could run a core Sanking. There's other things. They could even run, like, a mid Skywrath and put, like, a Sanking plus one, like, get, like, a Luna for Havos and run Doom in the jungle, but... The most standard thing is, like, Sanking Skywrath support duo. And Navi generally go for the aggressive support duos rather than running a kind of greedy jungler.
Team
so
pick.
Both teams probably looking for a mid-hero with their last Dragon pick. Knight.
Yeah, if this was a support Sanking, it would make me nervous Navi for how much the jungle is going to prioritize just, like, the Sanking and the Batrider. Let's say things go terribly for the offlane, you know, he's not going to be able to fall back on a big Blink farm-up because Sanking would be busy doing something like that. And things get a bit hairy as far as sharing the wealth and... Looks like to Moscow5, they round out their lineup with a Dragon Knight grab. More than likely the mid lane Dragon Knight that would be able to add a little bit extra sustain to himself. Pushing power certainly going to help out. You put that together with the Shadow Shaman wards, and they have some great siege ability. And with a Slark running around, it could be a bit finicky. And they have proper initiation and engagement with that. They could even grab something like a Blink Dagger, let's say, if they throw it together on your Slark or even Dragon Knight. And Tidehunter's going to be there as well. I'm really curious to see how Navi are going to look to round out their mid lane, because they're going to need someone to kind of crowd control or just be there to stop this heavy engagement factor that Moscow5 have thrown together.
Yeah, I think the TA ban was, I mean, it's very right considering you want to pick a DK for mid.
Yeah.
As you mentioned, then you can just beast on this hero. So good Navi.
They need someone elusive. I feel like there's going to be a lot of pressure for Moscow.
I think
this
they may go Windranger. That's my hunch here. Dendi likes playing the Windranger mid. It's something that Navi, they don't do it super frequently, but every now and then, like, as like a fifth pick mid hero, it just wins the lane as far as CS goes, can put a lot of pressure on, has got great wave clear, decent kind of semi carry, or even can be played as a carry. So
I'm still feeling the Puck, baby, come on.
Yeah, Puck's also still good. It's not as dominant in the mid lane, but it's still very good hero.
Yeah, I mean, we did see, I mean, normally on just on paper, the matchup definitely favors someone like Dragon Knight, but
5 seconds
remaining. That's going to be a Clink's grab.
Looks like mid two with Dendi playing it.
Wow.
They could still do some swaps and whatnot, but Doom definitely not really a good mid hero, I'd say.
Yeah.
Probably the least likely. It used to be you could play a mid back when you'd go level death, like as one of your main early game skills, and you can get like kills early on with bottle plus level death, but
mid lane Clink's though. That's some serious Starladder Kool-Aid that Dendi had after the after party or something. I guess they're just something funky
battle.
Fresh, and I'm sure Dragon Knight's going to be just as equally perplexed if the matchup is indeed going to be Dendi towards the mid. And I mean, he could dish out huge right-click damage, and Clink's is hard to get a hold of with Skeleton Walk, so even the bottom arrows might have a hard time finding their target. So we'll have to see if that's something they do fall back on here as we do hop our way into game number 2 of 6 today here for the Summit 2 by G2way.com. And Moscow5 going to be taking on Navi. I'll lead off your introductions here on the Radiant side. It is Team Moscow5. Leading out the top, it's going to be Topo. I'm trying my best here with some of these names, gods. It's the first time I've actually
physically. Topo is Tron.
Tron is going to be playing your Tidehunter. He's got the little octopus hat and everything ready to go. Mid lane, already going well past the enemy territory. It's going to be PGG He's playing this Morana, that support Morana already with Wards of Abundance. Would have loved to got a couple of wards down in the opposing jungle to prevent that jungle farm from either the Batrider or the Sand King, but he can't quite get in there. Navi already know this, so they're like being the bouncers for their own jungle. Like, don't even bother, buddy. Don't come in here trying to plant your own nonsense. Bottom lane, it leaves King R playing your support Shadow Shaman. He's going to be aiding in about Mr. Blow Your Brain playing the Slark. And, of course, that does leave the mid lane Tratata, or I believe you said was Vigas. Yep.
The battle begins.
The legend himself, one of the mans I heard was the originator, or one of the originators of the Tinker and Boots of Travel play back in the heyday. At least that's what I heard. It's a myth. The man, the myth, the legend.
Well,
kinda like
a lot
of
people like to say they invented things. I mean, you're talking about Bulba earlier, so.
Yeah, and Merlini's jungle play, I guess, you know. Back in the day. Anyways, he's going to be sporting your Dragon Knight in your mid lane, and we already have an Invis rune picked up here from King R. He's scouting out for an early pickoff here on Dendi.
Maybe with an arrow they get a kill, but even if they don't get a kill, helping DK, even just for a wave or two, get some early CS is huge. And, you know, Dendi didn't see an Invis picked up, but he's playing far back because he knows a rune was picked up. And worst case scenario, it's an Invis Shadow Shaman who first bloods you. And he's basically playing as if there is an Invis Shadow Shaman there.
Yeah, very defensively. Even if it sacrifices a lot of farm on the first wave, it's better than handing over a kill.
Like, it's a 1 in 5 chance it's an Invis, but the fact that, like, you don't see Shadow Shaman suggests that it could well be an Invis.
That game sense, man, it's tingling. It's tingling real damn good. So Dendi's going to avoid the potential Invis gank that could have been there. And Slark has been having a heyday here. It looks like immediately Funnik is just going straight for the jungle on this Batrider. He just wants nothing to do with that offlane Slark.
Oh, and he's gotten unlucky. Two Mud Golem camps. He was mid lane, Dendi, arrowed.
Well, that's what we're talking about, that dire side. You just don't know where it's coming from, apparently. And Klinks does get caught out early. Nice arrow coming in from PGG, a regular Robin Hood, is even though the game sense was there and tingling as hard as it was, ultimately he just gets caught out and he farms up.
Maybe in trouble. Vigos at mid lane here. He didn't retreat. He luckily, it looks like an arrow may save him. No, last hit. He just, he kept last hitting when Sand King just walked in. Sand King did a boot, so he had the movement speed advantage anyway, so maybe, I mean, maybe he was dead anyways, but he really hesitated to retreat off. Meanwhile, top lane, Tron taking
whoa. I mean, That's the problem. This is what makes Skywrath part of the reason he's so damn good. The low mana cost, the arcane bolts, they come out and they come out abundance.
I think Tide's happy with that because he saw Skywrath was completely depleted. This is what he has his salve.
Ooh,
and
give me that clarity.
You trade regen for mana right now.
He was trying to get close enough to just like get rid of that clarity too, but he couldn't quite get there. Pesky Skywrath. Meanwhile, nearby in the jungle, they get a hold of PGG here, and he is trying to get away with the benefit of that haste, and it looks like he will. Just really flirting with the enemy side. They are going real aggressive at the early start, just constantly keeping pressure all over the place, keeping this Batrider second-guessing on his own farm in the jungle. Dendi second-guessing where the arrow could be coming from, which they could be lobbing another right here. PGG found success in the previous one. Here comes another. Dendi, almost gets forced back into it. They try to time it out nicely with the fire nuke, but Dendi does stay planted and will not deter back into that arrow. Could have been another disaster there, but he lives, pops a salve, and he'll be able to stand and fight.
Yeah. Dendi's kind of in recovery mode to some extent since giving up the first blood, but he's still just zoning out Vigos really hard in this mid lane. There's not much DK can really do. Luckily for DK, he's already got Boots and Bottle thanks to the first blood roll.
And bottom lane, we're seeing the early Burrow Strike Death Pack follow-up. He's eating a reasonable amount of damage.
Batrider just, like, left this bottom lane and the Sand King tanked it. Batrider...
Uh-oh, they caught another arrow on Dendi. It looks like it was close range, though, so the stun is quickly worn out. Now, big damage right there from the lobbing Searing Oak. Oh, the miss! He needs another one. Oh, that miss might have cost him the kill, unfortunately. It would have been real close, though.
Yeah, I don't know if the base damage... base damage would not have been enough, I don't think, with Batrider's pitiful base damage. But I was about to talk about this Batrider. He's still level one. This Batrider's got nothing.
He's constantly kind of lingering nearby to be close aid to Dendi here, who just narrowly dodged an arrow again. PGG is just making Klinks' life a living hell, just constantly keeping him guessing. He doesn't have much for himself. Meanwhile, top lane, they're going for Tepo. He's diving in and out of these trees to kind of avoid any sort of...
action everywhere, like.
Yeah, this is making me sweat on my camera right now, not gonna lie, but they still managed to even it up for how hot and heavy it is. It's still only one for one as far as kills go, and
I don't know what the plan is for fun. You can't level one jungle on Batrider. The only way you can kinda do it is with these satyr creeps, which you got a single camp of satyrs on this triple stack. That's like the only camp you can kill with level one Firefly. Like reliably. Like you can kill like an ogre camp okay, it's kinda slow because they're tanky, but
Do you think that it just was for the better he went to the jungle? Like, why did he abandon the lane so early? He's just like, I don't want anything to do with Slark. I feel like Batrider Slark's not too terrible, but enough that he could find some CS, at least under the tower, but more importantly, the levels. Mm-hmm. So at least he can get, like, a level 3 base, then maybe move into a jungle, which could have been stacked a little bit from your support, but I was expecting this in the draft. Like, Sand King's like, I need to find my own farm myself, buddy. And, you know, you have Skywrath Mage. He can't really do stacks. He's busy harassing out the Tide, making sure the offlaner gets nothing in his lane. So a real, a lot of jobs to take care of a Navi and not a lot of people to do it.
He's now hit level 2, so he can at least kill this big camp with, like, a bunch of Napalm stacks, which he's got a good quad stack on. So the catch-up will happen. It's just going to be a very late comeback for him.
I mean, on the other side, PGG, who's been still lobbing arrows and just flirting with this mid lane, hasn't got anything. He's only level 1, so this is the problem with the support Morana who moves around. But it's the same way, like, Puppy likes to play Morana. It's very selfless play. It's more like, I want my teammates to be able to have the impact. Now he scouts out and sees Sand King here playing down the offensive ward. They should be able to see it and quickly ping it out as his ward count goes down to 1. And they're still just, like, sitting there flirting. Now, I don't know if you confirm this. AB Rain, is that FNG? We're just under a different alien?
It's
got to
be. He's tagged up as Navi player, so
we're just going to assume that. In case anyone was confused watching, of course. Yeah, it's not FNG's out, kicked out after Star Ladder and or anything like that.
Even
but.
Funny,
he's
going to clear it. This big Sam is going to die to the nuke.
Whoops. Let's just kind of rest in pieces, my friend.
He missed some experience there from one of the big trolls. Like, the Firefly killed it after he died, so he'd be level 4, I want to say.
Oh, you know what? Moscow5 pinging out. If they can find their way into the jungle, they're maybe thinking that there's a stack left over they could take. Meanwhile, it is going to be Dendi caught out with an arrow again. Now he's in Skeleton Walk, but that's not going to matter too much. They just quickly muscle him down, and, well, Dendi ends up falling, and Tidehunter picks up the kill. He may not have gotten a lot in the offlane, but he finds something big right there. And just like I said, they're going to go into the jungle and see if there's a big stack for them to help finish up that Funnik had fallen to. And there he is going to work. Those Mud Golems still there. Gosh, dang it. And now they're going to see the illusions. Funnik's struggle continues here to find a place for himself and build up some early farm.
Yeah, he's going to kind of poke around at this Tide, but not much you can do against a level 5 Tide with Magic Stick except feed in these Magic Stick charges. Funnik is, he's just going to have to keep on sitting back, keeping these stacks going and farming for a little bit. This Blink is not going to be coming for like 12, 13 minutes. Radiant's I think like you said earlier, the Morana being so attack. Low level and kind of, I wouldn't say low impact, but could become low impact in the mid game is kind of like where Funnik says, it's okay, we're not actually under that much pressure because it's not like they have supports who are just farming. King R is doing
arrow
well
catches on Dendi, the backhand side. Oh. It comes in from the north and still the pressure mounts. But can they be able to burn him down before they get the Skeleton Walk? They can't. He didn't have the mana for both that Dragon Knight. Could have Dragon Tail there at the end, but I don't know if it would have been enough. He was banking on the burst from Breath Fire.
With Death Pact HP, Dendi's just a bit too tanky here, it looks like.
So this might be the opportunity where, you know, he feels a little more safe and PGG needs to be a little more selfish because as mid-game approaches, he's just going to be a quick and easy pick-off target, especially for someone like a Klinks if he manages to throw together anything reasonable, which this kind of game, a mid-lane Klinks, I mean, normally it's like a build-up of Orchid or something to lead things off for good pick-off potential, and then now with their recent changes, he could go for something crazy like a Desolator, being able now the Searing Arrows can benefit from it, but that's free and easy pick-off on supports that are too busy roaming around.
I think we may see some like Eternal Envy style Klinks play from Dendi where it's like he's got the fast. Well, not so much, I mean, Blink eventually, but more in the sense that I think he's going to roam a lot early.
Yeah.
Like your Dyer's traditional Klinks play is farm for your Orchid. The way Envy plays it is he goes safe lane, but he'll get like fast bottle, Sol Ring, maybe some treads, and then just go gank. He'll gank mid lane, gank all over the place. Dendi may try and do something similar here because just with level 4 Searing Arrows, your damage output is huge with the 4 Searing Arrows, 1 straight fill.
And we'll see here. Havos had recently picked up a Midas on his Doom, so he's banking on the extra bit of greed early to have a bigger presence in the late game. We'll see if he decides to go more utility or kind of put more around his ultimate with the Magnum's kind of a grab. And your Blink is also going to be picked up here from Slark. So unlike the last game, he's bringing in some really, really nice farm. And his ganking potential is also going to get picked up probably around the same time as Dendi's looking to get something done on his Klinks, which speaking of, he's going to rummage through this bottom area. They could look to converge as it is going to be FNG on the scene. Now, he is not level 6 yet, just with a simple 2 and 2 level. And 1,300 gold, he's on the way towards a Blink Dagger in a respectable amount of time, but any sort of unnecessary feed could really put him off.
Yeah. I'm surprised Slack got Blink like before treads and everything. Dyer's like normally you think like you're here like center or something, you go for the Blink then go straight for a game. Problem is you're a Slack, you're a carry, like in the at least some sense. So he's not going to pick up the Blink and immediately go for a gank. So I feel he could have just got more benefit out of getting, like, the treads and getting the blink. Like, getting a blink around 15 minutes on Slark is fine. You don't need the, like, first item blink that a hero likes.
Arrow? Wow, man.
Jeez, these
arrows. They're really testing Dendi right now with his true matrix to kind of sidestep these arrows. BGG is just not letting up. He's as annoying as I am when I play this hero. Just the best thing I can do is just throw out arrows all day. Hoping if you get that big catch in your mid lane will profit huge from it. Because a kill there plus a follow-up tower would have been nice. But he's still waking to work. They blink on pass. Arrow's still going to catch and find its mark somehow on Vanskor, who was busy with Slark.
I don't know how that hit. But
I mean, he just lobbed it in there, knew that the creeps were all on his side, so they're going to fly right on through. And unfortunately for Vanskor, he walks into it.
Then he almost got the tower deny. He hit it and then went into Ghost Walk, but the Skeleton Walk, but his hit left the tower with like 2 HP.
Oh, Funic caught by the tower, and a rotation in allows for an easy Shackle setup, and he goes down as if things weren't hard enough for Funic trying to find the farm early on. He's now 600, but hey, there, King R, this is free food if you can get it. Bam! Boom! See you later. And Navi will be able to finally find himself another kill. Now matched up 5-2. Very early look at the Goldcraft will allow Moscow 5 to get things damn near even with that tower takedown.
Yeah. I'm also just farming up the storm, and he probably goes blink next and then looks to help out his team. And I think this is kind of what I thought Slark would do more of. Like, focus early on just maximizing your farm and then get the blink later on when you're more fight ready. Slark, as he proved in mid lane, is fight ready enough.
He might want to put this Ravage to use here. Poe's got it.
Yeah, Ravage into an arrow. If you can kill off a boss, now's a great time to do it before he buys that blink.
He did just use the arrow trying to go for Skywrath, but it's already off its cooldown, ready to go, and they had a DD to work with at that time, but not going to be able to find the opportunity, as it looks like Havos pulls back towards his own jungle, where many people are farming and trying to make something work. Still the stacks building up here from both sides, and they're looking to just kind of farm it all together. The buddy-buddy system is very much real here in the Navi jungle.
Yeah, I think Navi just have to give up top. DK even TP'd up here as well. They're not ready to fight. No Doom Blink. No Batrider Blink. And Dendi is just a bit too squishy at this point, it feels like. So.
Yeah, they're going to need to wait for these items to come online. Even FNG on the bottom with his solo bit of farm time. Got him up to this level 6 in his epicenter, but
The Serpent Wards are used, though, so that's good news for Navi. Moscow 5, they don't know it, but they could have got the tower without the Serpent Wards. It's kind of just like a... Let's be on the safe side, drop them down just in case Navi decide to engage with a... Because for all they know, Navi could suddenly have a blink on Batrider or Doom. Under attack. In theory, Batrider should have blink by now.
And it looks like Dragon Knight, who still reserved his dragon form, is kind of scouting out to see where the hell Navi are. And they are in the jungle farming it up. Then he slips by with his skeleton walk. Arrow flies out, will not find its mark. And while Dragon Knight waits out for the 12-minute rune, Denny might try to snag it right here. Let's see. Nope. Dragon Knight's going to be able to quickly grab it, bottles it up. It's an illusion rune, and that puts him back towards mid lane. Now, they still have a tier 1 on the bottom lane to still get a hold of, and, you know, they might consider doing that soon before Funic. He's about to have his Blink Dagger, and so is Sand King, so this could be a big turning point right now for Navi to kind of take the game back.
Yeah. These Blink Daggers have to do some work here. Right?
Yeah.
They're going to have a lot of them, so...
And it is going to be Dendi going for an Orchid. He already has the Oblivion Staff and the Sage's Mask together.
I'm surprised Havos is going straight BKB with the Doom. Like, I think you want to go BKB against these heroes. Ravage, BK's done Mirana and all that, but would have maybe preferred a Blink into BKB. But when you've got two good Blink initiators in Bat and Sanky, he probably sees that his team have enough good initiators.
Yeah, to bring it towards Doom and him not really have to travel himself in, but... For now, they're going to look to make it work, and, you know, we'll see if the Blink Dagger pays off as Tidehunter about to complete his own Blink Dagger.
Navi, you've got to try and defend this tower. Like, you've just got your Blinks. Like, if you're not going to defend now with your Blinks, like, when are you going to defend? Sure, your lineup gets stronger with an Orchid and all that.
Arrow flies out. Not going to catch on anyone. Just kind of scouting in the meantime. Not going to get any side vision. FNG's lurking well in behind, but I don't see any other Navi troops rotating in, so unless the two of them can get it done... They're not going to get
holding the Shadow Shaman Ward, so Dyer's not going to use attack. Those just for the tier 1. They want to either wait for a team fight or maybe even try and push on.
They can get away with at least one or the other, either one being the Dragon Form and the other being the Wards. Oh, the deny is going to be Dyer's there. Funnick creeps himself in and is able to get the last hit.
They got Blink on Tide, though. Radiant's they may go for the tier 2 because they have got that great initiation. That
yeah, and the Wards still to use, so fortified. Let's see as they kind of move on forward.
Dendi needs to pressure this mid tier 1. I think Radiant's this is an okay decision for Navi attack. To just try and take these trades like Dendi's doing. They can go for the trade and then still defend as well. That's the beauty of it.
Arrow straight across is actually going to catch FNG in the jungle, and this is going to be perfect for them to move on through. They get wards that can hit the tower and hit the Sand King, but they can't get in there.
Oh, Vigos, he tried to get the stun, but the pathing kind of was just like...
He's in the middle of the trees. I mean, he's blocked in, so he couldn't quite get proper vision, it would seem. They're still pinging it out, and they're even putting...
Oh, the second
arrow catches him in the same spot, and they finish it finally now. Blowyourbrain didn't have to commit into that tree corner, and he's kind of locked in there for now, but there's still plenty of space from the finish here. This tier 2 tower, that's two tower pickoffs. They did take the mid, though Dendi did finish what he started there in the mid lane, so Navi get a little bit of something, but I still think Moscow 5, especially with that pickoff. Another deny! Snuck in there with a Batrider! What a player, Phonic right there, denying not one, but two towers in that bottom lane. Wow.
With that crappy Batrider base damage.
That's something. Blinks in and gets the, gotcha.
Okay.
That's huge. That's huge goal that could have been swung towards Moscow 5. I mean, yeah, they're still ahead by just over 2K, but now Havo's going to get caught out. Unfortunately, it looks like Vegas is going to hold of him. Dragon Tail, Breath follow-up, and there's not much he can do. Now Dendi even going to be spotted. Quickly Sheep, nice reaction right there from King R to see him coming in from behind, but they don't have detection for a chase.
What was Havo's even doing there? I didn't see like the what led up to that moment. Maybe they were hunting with Dendi scouting, but it's still a very bizarre
classic
place for Havo's
for
to be.
Boast. Yeah. Way on the enemy side. Just, hey, nice little snack you got here. I got my Midas. I got my Devourer. I'll get rid of this quick. But he falls out on the retreat from what was a successful push regardless on the bottom lane from Moscow 5. So, you know, that kind of helps things a bit fortified. More for Moscow 5 after getting those objectives taken. And now your supports are bringing in extra gold. But PGG, man, he's so selfless. He's like, you know what? More wards. More wards the better. He's really opting for that ward kind of a build. As he's going right into the bottom lane, but he's going to be alone. Yeah, he can get this on Dendi, but there is a whole Navi squad nearby that's like, hey, how you doing? Whoa, nicely burrow strike dodge, but regardless, they're still on the hunt. Hefty burst, and yeah, PGG, admirable effort trying to go for a defense, but clearly he did not know that the whole Navi squad were right there.
Talk about classic Kvoss, that's your classic PGG.
Yeah, this is like, who's going to battle it out more?
He's like, there's a chance to make a play, which is arrow Dendi and deny the tower. He doesn't think about... What if it doesn't work and what happens afterwards? Because even if you get the Tau tonight, it's worth it for a death, but you're 100% dead there.
Still, even if it was just Dendi, like, even if he got the deny, I don't know.
He wasn't going
to kill
Dendi.
Was gonna, yeah, Dendi might have been able to still turn around and just kind of hunt him down. It's not like PGG has much muscle. It's a simple set of shoes. And though it was an admirable effort and he managed to dodge the Burrow Strike with a leap, it's clear that he's just not going to be going anywhere. So an unnecessary feat kind of helps things out after Havos got taken down on the opposing side, which he's made his return to the top lane. He has that BKB you were talking about. 1,300 gold now. He's building up a lot of farm. Where do you take it from here if you're Doom, though?
I think you still want to go back to the play.
Well, we can't go back when he's a chicken because he gets caught out with a sheep. He's forced to pull out that BKB, and they're like, okay, no problem. Free BKB charge for one hex. We'll just kind of leave now.
He BKBs and goes for a Devour Midas. He doesn't try and, like, Doom the Shadow Shaman and go for a kill. He's like, nope. Midas, Devour, and then go back and farm.
So it was 10 seconds. Now down to 9 at the expense of just a simple hex. Not too shabby, I guess, for Moscow 5 on that one, but he kind of needed to. I mean, otherwise they would have just locked him down, and it would have been a bit till reinforcements were going to be there, and as Moscow 5 already converged up to this top lane with a Ravage in the pocket ready to go, and Slark just kind of creeping on through. He's going to find the extra bit of vision. They even commit the wards and the dragon form for this one, so they really want this tier 2. Bottom lane, Funnick's already pushing forward, but we have yet to see him really pull off his first big blink lasso attempt.
This really highlights the patch changes. This game, M5 are the ones completely controlling the pace of the game, taking towers left, right, and center, but it's Na'Vi, ahead by 2 to 3k gold. Like, they've just managed to sustain this farm lead of theirs. Blowyourbrain and mid's going to get doomed
out. There we go. Yeah, they get doomed out. Meantime,
he's
they do
fine.
Go for PGD on the bottom. They will manage to take him down. Meanwhile, back in mid lane, they get a hold of Havost. They press on forward, and he still doesn't have that BKB he would love from before, and they stun it on up. They know this. They move on through. It's about to be up momentarily, but he's about to go down. Burrow Strike does save him, but right clicks coming out too hard and heavy. DK gets it, and they also take down FNG on the Sand King. This is a huge swing for Moscow 5, who already were ahead in this one, and they get about 1,500 gold from that.
That fight, I feel like, is the first fight they've actually won. Like, sure, they were getting kills before that and getting towers, but the entire time Dyer's Navi was out farming and pulling ahead, this is the first time there's been a big fight go M5's way where it really feels like they actually pull ahead because of it. They even, like, Dendi's still farming bottom lane and getting a tier 2, though. Dyer's so, as good a fight as it was, it's still, like, pressure all over coming from Navi.
I can't help but feel like maybe they partied a little too hard at Starlight. I mean, you got Phonic who goes straight to the jungle, feeds over to neutrals. Dendi's getting caught out with arrows left, right, and center from mid lane. We have Havost. Well, Havost is Havost, so he doesn't really need to be having on too much of the Kool-Aid or not. But regardless, it just feels like a bit of shaky play coming out from Navi's side. And Moscow 5, a team that's, you know, behind 3-4 a record, they'll certainly take the win. And I'm sure a lot of happy Arcane bettors are really happy and giddy at this point. Navi are looking to bounce back.
All right. Yeah, I think Navi is still just... They haven't shown the real power of their lineup yet is the thing.
Which like, is there. I mean, yeah. Mystic Flare, you have and lots of lockdown with Sand King and Epicenter that has yet to really make a huge impact. And, of course, Doom. I don't even think I've seen one very assertive Doom kind of come off where they could chase someone down and actually get the job done. And Dendi, who now has his Orchid together, you know, yet to really find a lot of pickoffs. He's got PGG here and there, but nothing crazy significant.
That's the thing. They're not missing out on items right now. It's not like, oh, they're not showing the strength of their lineup because they're behind, lacking items, lacking levels. They've got all the levels and items they need. They just... The execution and team play just hasn't been there, to be honest. Like, yeah. It's just been a pretty poor showing from Navi so far, but even so, they're still ahead on team net worth. They'll find Dyer's the fights they probably need to eventually, attack. And I still favor Navi's position.
Yeah. They're looking still relatively sharp as the Dragon Tail's going to fly off. It looks like they want to go get a hold of Dragon Knight. They pull him up to the high ground very nicely here, and Fudd is going to make a quick escape. Meanwhile, though, Slark does quickly clean up. That Skywrath Mage support, and now Dragonite, stranded on the high ground here. He's going to be forced to TP away.
Another fight that, yeah, Navi just can't really take. I think the Doom is really hurting not having Blink Dagger. Sure, you've got two teammates with Blink, but because Doom's one with BKB, he wants to be kind of... Doom wants to be initiating first. Like, Sankin can't really start off a fight with his Blink stun. Batrider can, but it's kind of risky when you're like a little bit behind and against the Tide. So I think the boss is the best hero to initiate with a Blink. Blink in, do someone BKB, and take on five heroes.
There he goes. He's taking a Tomb. They turn back with the Doom. Is Dendi nearby? Still he is. But the arrow's going to catch Havost from behind. They finish off Havost, and now they put their sights on Dendi. With a sentry also down, they lock him in place. Can they catch up before he gets out of the sentry range? No, they cannot. He gets out and away, luckily, but Dragon Knight going to live on. And at the same time, you see Tidehunter getting work on the mid lane. They take down Skywrath again, plus the Tier 2 tower. Blow your brain, trying to get away. Can they at least get some sort of redemption here? They should be able to. Oh, they get it done right there, and it's a dominating streak there for Dendi as he makes his rotation play back to mid lane. They find a little bit of something, but Moscow 5 continue to bring in the tower kills. So the Tier 2 plus Havost, I still think it's a nice trade for Moscow.
Yeah. Whenever the trades happen, it seems fine. It's like the in-between the trades. Moscow 5 aren't really farming.
Arrow, wow, very nice catch on Dendi. Under a sentry as well, but can flimsy little PGG get it done? Nope, I can't, unfortunately. Bye.
Yeah, he's gone for the all-in arrow build, which is okay, but...
It's okay if you're Cupid, I guess. But other than that, you just got some shoes and a magic wand, and you're looking like a little fairy princess who can kind of only set up stuns at this point.
I like the two arrow, then max Starstorm. Like, yeah. You could have... The second point is pretty value, attack. Like it goes up to 140 damage from 50, but...
Yeah, and it's easier to farm with, because you're at a point like this, you need the farm. So you might need to pull out that Starstorm to just kind of bring in some creeps for yourself. I mean, he's playing not even having upgraded shoes at this point is a waiting death sentence.
True
as he's
hard
only about 700.
Mirana, like Shadow Shaman's got Blink and Ghost Scepter.
Another arrow! Woof! That one goes right behind Dendi as he makes his way back. But he should know a sentry was there to kind of scout him out. Yeah. So they turn back. Quickly take out that sentry that was just planted, and they plant an obs of their own. So a lot of ward control really coming out. I mean, I guess that's your hard support, Mirana doing work, constantly having the wards available and at the ready to kind of remove everything and keep vision on your Skeleton King if needed. Not Skeleton King, but the Bone Clinks.
This bottom tier 2 tower, anytime M5 group up or go for a push, Navi, Dendi especially, is just going to be back there pressuring. They're 5-manning mid to get this tier 2, but they're going to have to immediately TP bottom, or they're going to be trading towers.
Are fortified.
Havost building towards, he has this plate mail already. Is this going to be an AC grab to kind of help with a little bit of durability and siege? Or is he going to go Shivas to try to slow down the attack roll of DK and Slark?
I think the Shivas is slightly better item, but...
Oh man, look who's in the base already, though. Moscow 5 pulling out all of their true siege power with the wards and the dragon form already popped. 15 seconds for Ravage, however. Jumping in, Doom catches on Tide, who didn't have Ravage regardless, but they fire back with a big Epicenter, Mystic Flare, and they do take down the Tide, but they return, lose their Skywrath Mage. Havost presses outside the base, but it is going to be the Shadow Shaman who benefits from it, gets the Unstoppable Streak. It's going to be a quick escape from DK, and ends up being a 1-for-2. The trades still continue to build up nicely here for Moscow 5, not only winning the fight, but taking down a Tier 3 and a set of racks from those wards.
Yeah. I think Navi were thinking, like, oh, they're just going for our Tier 2. Let's just keep with the plan, which is, like, pressure bottom, try and look for this Tier 2 bottom, and just keep kind of avoiding fights or, like, out farming them. King Lar
is so farmed. He's got a blink. He's got a ghost. His level 2 wards. I mean,
here comes the point booster to start working on an ag scepter.
Like, he is grossly farmed.
This is why you play your hard support Marana, because like a full position Marana, like you can't really carry. Like you can get like a drums, maybe like a defusal or something, but you're never going to truly carry. But you get a full position Shadow Shaman with blink and ag scepter later on. You do a lot of work.
Alright, Navi going behind the back here.
Alright, dude picked up his blink. This was so important. Like, this was a largely why Navi were doing so poorly. He should have got this before the BKB, or at least right after.
Arrow's gonna be there. Catches Dendi of all people. Allows Slark to move in and open up. The force is gonna be there to try to pull Dendi out. A Ravage follow-up. Very nice from Moscow 5, and they just start cleaning up everything that remains. Three quickly down. A very low Roche is just perfect. For Moscow 5, it just keeps coming up roses right now for them as they not only pull ahead now 19-6 as far as kills, they're going to benefit from this Aegis grab. There's no Batrider to kind of threaten them from a quick steal. Dendi was too low, so he had to make his escape. And
they're going to go mid with Serpent Lords, maybe. Get the melee racks. Worth a drop on that, even though it's just the one racks there. It's a melee, so it's a very important pickup.
They quickly go in. That's what they want. They clear out the creeps like they're butter.
20 seconds on Doom. This is a dead racks. No glyphs there.
They might not even need to use the wards for this. They can save the wards for maybe a second tier 3 or... Yeah, they're just going to make words of the dragon form. Arrow to zone and check out. They're not going to see anything. Dendi's still on the bottom lane pushing. He doesn't have a TP to pull on back once his team is online, but there it goes. Rack's already down. Now the roads are going to come down here because they want to get at least a tier 3.
He's in a good position, though, but his blink's on cooldown for 5 seconds. He's going to go for the epicenter, but at least a tier 3 going down.
Here it comes. They're already pulling back. However, so this Epi going to be to nothing. Even the Moonlight Shadow. Now, they don't have detection. It looks like in the front lines quite yet. They're making a move onto King R. They want that sweet bounty. Now moving in, Slark looking to clean on up and take down FNG, who's very low. Ends up falling, even though pulled to the high ground. Dragonite will end up falling. Meanwhile, up and behind, Slark looking to make his escape, outrunning the Arcane Bolt. On the bottom, Havos is able to clean up and catch up with that Shaman. Take him down. Now PGG under pressure should fall here. The Flimsy Marana goes down. In the first fight that Navi can take advantage of, they still end up losing their mid lane set of racks and huge damage on a tier 3.
Yeah. They completely whiffed the epicenter as well. That just goes to show like what Havos can do when he's got the blink to give that added mobility. Yeah. He just needed to be able to get in the front.
Oh, Slark still in the neighborhood. Nice little free grab right there on the lingering advance score.
That's huge, getting the gem back.
And on a Slark of all people. In a team that has Slark, that's just free map control anytime you want it, so.
The Shadow Shaman did something smart. He actually hid the gem in the trees when he got doomed and was going to die, but Navi did end up finding and scouting it out. It almost worked. Gem once again back in Moscow 5's hands. And
I mean, you can see the fight potential now from the side of Navi when they synergize everything, especially without that epicenter really coming into full effect. But the problem is it too little too late at this point? Moscow 5 inheriting a lot from these big objectives, and now you're going to have a constant pressured mid lane that Navi can't quite farm as easily as they did before. And, you know, we'll see. Moscow 5, seeing that big team fight, I don't think they want to let up. I think any chance they get, they're going to continue to push. I mean, they still have the Aegis here for Slark. And I know they want to use it before it expires, so they're already migrating right back towards the up half of the map.
The tempo of this game definitely favors M5, because even if they just keep trading, like, theoretically, even if they get these Raxes and just keep trading kills and stuff, Navi are using their BKB, and M5 are eventually going to have this refresher on Tide, so even if this game goes another 20-25 minutes with M5 struggling to get Raxes, eventually you get to a point where Navi have two Doom and Klinks both with 5-second BKB.
Oh, here we go. Early Epi this time. Jumping on in and coming right forward. They get huge damage to take down the Dragonite. Return Ravage, however, stops the roll of Navi. And now BKB Bop Kavos looking to go toe down. And now we have DK buying back coming right towards the top tier 2 tower. But Slark will end up feeding over his Aegis life. Still going to be able to come back. They want to quickly clean up PGG's support. Meanwhile, back in behind, Shadow Shaman finishes up the Dendi Klinks right now. Tries to get away under Moonlight Shadow, but Dust is going to be there. And meanwhile, back in behind, you can also see that...
huge Klinks kill. That just secured them Raxes, I think, with Klinks dead.
And no buyback.
Yeah, I think they just go into the high ground now. DK did buy back. And he's now returned to the fight. Doesn't have dragon form, but he can pop the drums for his team. He can just add some extra damage. And Raxes are going down here, it looks like. No epicenter. Doom is back online. So Havos is to get in there ASAP.
There's your buyback coming out from Phonic. This could be an all or nothing. No lasso available regardless. But their Rax does end up falling. It only leaves up the melee. So of the two Rax, obviously just the range is going to be falling to their benefit. But still, Navi, man. Backs against the walls here with Dendi falling. That puts him behind a little bit more. He has the damage, but apparently he's just too squishy. If he gets caught out, even by the likes of a Shadow Shaman, he really can't contest because the rest of his team was busy doing objectives on the other side of the fight, taking down supports.
Bit by bit, they're just chipping away at Navi's base. So every time they come, they may lose a few heroes, have to buy back a DK in that case. But if you get a tier 3 and a ranged Racks, this is like your 6.81 Shadow Shaman Dota. We saw a lot of it kind of at TI4 and stuff, where it's like you can, like, maybe, like, for Navi, like, that's an okay-ish hold, like, in terms of heroes they lost and heroes they kill. But your just base is slowly disappearing, and eventually there's going to be nothing left.
And when he gets in there and he drops those wards, you have to make the call as far as, do we focus these wards and try to get them down and save our base, or do we risk trying to make a jump in play? But when you have people jumping in like Tidehunter with Ravage to stop them from getting anything off, you know, given the people who don't have BKBs, and Dragonite as well also unleashing his own Fiery Fury, it becomes a question of Navi being able to go for the right objectives in the heat of the moment.
And they went for the kills, and the problem was Slack had an Aegis. If that Slack didn't have an Aegis, it would have been a perfect decision.
But yeah.
Chasing that far out of their base and then just getting an Aegis. You killed the DK as well, but he bought back. So as far as M5 are concerned, they were ready for any Navi aggression.
Speaking of Navi aggression, they are now moving as a pack. They quickly smoke up, and they're looking to go for something, but it's promptly pinged out. PGG, the captain, playing that very selfless support, making the calls from his team from the back lines here.
He got some great
but they're going to move right in. And the courier actually goes down, just kind of goes towards PGG. And even though they ping it out, they don't see the big game coming their way, and they just lose two at the drop of a hat. And now Dendi, BKB pop, pushing on forward, wanting to get for more. Slark, his Lincoln's going to be popped, and now he tries to desperately get up and away from the high ground, and now it's just a constant death ball surging towards him, and a few more right clicks, he'll go down, and now they turn their sights on King R, who actually pulls out the wards. That's just free gold! Oh, the rubber band is real, guys, and it's got its grasp tightened up. Moscow 5 hand over a huge fight towards Navi.
Man. That's like a almost 4k plus gold swing. Yeah, 4.5k almost. That's painful stuff.
And I thought they knew it was coming. He pings out exactly where the smoke is. I mean, they don't have vision, but just I thought the sense was there. Like, okay, they might be coming this way. They're clearly all in their jungle, but I guess he thought maybe they were just farming in the jungle.
I think they kind of knew. Like, the way DK was positioned in the tree, so he revealed the smoke without showing Navi where it was, but PGG on the Mirana was, like, just chilling on the ledge. The courier also revealed, like, where they were because it was flying across the river.
Which they lost as well.
Yeah.
Even more gold towards Navi, and now no courier grab.
Just giving Navi the info, like, where the DK was in those trees because of the courier trajectory really added up, and DK looked like he just died instantly, really.
Though Topo, man, he is about to have his refresher, though. He is, like, 100 gold away. That's huge.
As long as, end of the day, you're M5, you're up 1.5 Raxes.
Yeah.
You've got a range Rax at top. Late game with Refresher Tide is always very scary. Navi, BKBs.
They have two on the two most important, of course, Dendi and Havos. Funnik is still trying to throw his together.
Dendi's got 5 seconds on his, though, and Doom's at seven. No, Doom's at five, and Dendi's at seven.
And if, you know, he's busy using that, let's say, for the Ravage, Shao Shan will be right there to follow up, and he can kind of go to town on your Klinks with any of his abilities. Yeah. Or if they try to get a hold of him early and he pops his BKB before the big team engagement, he won't have it for that Ravage, so you're being pretty finicky with your BKBs as it is at this point, because he picked it up so early, he's already only down to 5 seconds.
This is a tough game for Navi to win, just because of the Tide Refresher and the short the short BKB durations. They've got to farm up a Refresher on Havos, I think probably is his next item, just to have double BKB as well as the double Doom, of course, being the big thing. But I think Refresher on Doom is crucial.
Funnik is trying to deward, but he's going to run right into an obs. They're going to see him as he comes into the obs, and quickly Slark jumps in. They could lose Funnik quickly if he doesn't get out. As the rest of the team approaches, Funnik is able to force staff away. Link, it's going to be Pop return, Burrow Strike, but right there is going to be Tide. Pulls out the Ravage, but order the BKB was popped from Havos, and he finishes what they started, taking down the Slark. Now big pressure on Topo, who's doomed up. He'll lead away into his ultimate doom, where Havos will finish him off. They also get a hold of Skywrath Mage here. DK able to get it done, but will he die on the way out as the BKB does end? And now Dendi looking to clean house. Another big fight that looks like could go the way of Navi. They try to hide behind the wards, but the arrow locks him. Oh, he's trying to desperately clean out the wards so they don't do too much damage, and he is able to step away, thankfully. And now those wards become huge money into the pocket of Havos. Another great fight, I'd have to say, for Navi. Yeah. They only lose Funnik and Skywrath Mage, and they take down Slark. They take down both Shadow Shaman and Tidehunter. They live through the Ravage, and they also eat up the wards.
Just realizing how actually strong their lineup is, they have to fight outside of their base, because once Serpent Wards are down, Rax is likely to die, but Fighting outside their base favors them as well, because once those serpent wards go down, they're not really attacking during the team fight. Not until the end when they chase. M5 were forced to like drop serpent wards just kind of around one or two Navi heroes, but Navi just then chase away from the wards or fight outside of the serpent wards, and Moscow 5 just don't really have the best damage output. The serpent wards are a huge chunk of it in these fights.
Vos getting in there and getting the Doom Untied, he only got the one Ravage off. It's also a big, big
mech
thing.
Couldn't get the second, so.
Yeah, so. He gets it done, and now they're moving into Rosh, where it looks like contention. PGG throws out the arrow, and thank you, sir, as you'll be able to stun down Rosh, but they're getting a lot more.
PGG could go for the steal. The gem is on Sank. No?
Oh, they'll see him now, but we'll see. A skirmish does break out between the four. Stun, though. Rosh is getting in on the action, stunning them in their place. Epicenter on the way out. It's not going to catch on anyone. Just a BKB DK. Now they turn back. There's your secondary Ravage from the previous fight. Able to go in and take out Havos. Rosh still stands as Tepo moves in. Phonic, though, brings up the Dragonite to the high ground, who now has no TP or any way to get to low ground just yet. So they lose the Slark, they lose PGG, Dragon Knight stuck on the high ground, and now Ty goes up there and ate him.
He passes his TP. It's
actually nice grab right there. So he's going to be able to benefit from that pocket his Dragon form, but he's still stuck there. He needs to get away before Funnick has his flame break, so he can't quite leave.
He's holding it for the TP.
Yep, he's like, try to get away, sir, I'll just flame break you out, and ultimately Dragon Knight's just going to be put up on a nice pedestal for them to farm down. Oh, another big one for Navi right there. Just to add the cherry on top, he finishes him off with that flame break, just to let him know you weren't going anywhere. Don't worry about it.
That's some clowny fights, but Navi just finally finding their footing. They've been ahead on farm like most of the game, but they just didn't figure out how to team fight until recently. Like it doesn't really even feel like any item pickups have made the difference. Sure, Dendi's suddenly a lot more farm with the Daedalus. Havos has a Shiver's Guard, but it's just the fact Havos is blinking in and dooming people, which is winning them fights now. Yeah. Like, that fight, he didn't actually have or need the Doom, but that fight was more about M5 going in with... Slark was paper. That Slark needed a BKB. He just melted to the damage after he kind of pounced in and blinked in looking for a right-hand steal.
Other Slarks, you know, they'd get the early makings of a Scotty, and they benefit a lot from all those extra bit of stats, but he went with the Lincolns, and now he's going, you know, into the Basher
build. He needs BKB. He's not being doomed,
so
the BKB is definitely... BKB is definitely good when you're not being doomed, so... McLean can still DPS you through it, but Sanking and Skyrath and like the flame breaks was what kind of messed him up in that fight.
Any lockdown, you can follow up with huge bursts from that Skyrath, and even though the Skyrath may not have a lot to his name, he'll have a lot to dish out as far as tools, and Slark could be caught out very easily on the back end of a big Mystic Flare ultimate, and even he will be taken out of the fight very damn quick, and your BKBs are slowing to dwindle down. Now Dragonite, only a 5-second BKB to him, he's been just really putting it to hard use in each of these fights. Your Courier is going to be back up now for your Moscow 5 squad. PGG still bringing in those wards, doing the heavy duty to try to bring this map back in their favor, because as Navi begins to build up, their defenses grow that much stronger, and Moscow 5's chances of just kind of going for an all-out base siege are just kind of fading away slowly, because Navi just keeps catching them outside the base in these fights where they're coming out on top.
I don't think Moscow 5 get any more chances to break the base without actually winning a fight against Navi. M5 have to look at this game and be like, we're only...
Wow. That was...
One Daedalus grid, basically.
Yeah, just quick jump in, shivers.
Moscow 5 basically have to win a fight at this stage if they ever want to get another rack. So they're going to be looking to itemize and just play around the fact, hey, look, Navi may actually go for a push, and we can use the high ground advantage to actually get two Ravages off ideally. If Havos doesn't BKB the first Ravage, you Ravage him a second time, maybe win a fight.
Now, look how much freaking armor Vos has, man, with the Shivas and the AC, man. He is a beast. 34 armor sporting. This tower eating even more damage because of the right click coming out from Dendi and that AC just contributing a whole lot. And they're slowly taking towers back. They have another tier 2 to work with on the top lane. That's a lot of gold for Navi to just kind of pick on up. The big gold swing that happened now is pushing Navi ahead towards that 5k mark. And Moscow 5, they might need to consider plan B here. Split push action, somehow getting Shadow Shaman maybe towards the base or something, because I also fear for the high ground defense. Now, this could be plan B. They are pulling out the Moonlight Shadow, trying to see if they can scavenge to get a hold of everyone, but Navi already gone.
I think Moscow 5 definitely have to consider farming and split pushing to the actual late game, because right now, Doom and Klink's pretty much both maxed out in a lot of ways. Klink, is he actually going to be going for a Deso with this?
Searing Arrow minus armor working together with that AC, man. It can get ugly real quick.
I mean, Deso not generally considered a late game item because, like, the minus armor at a certain point here is going to get high enough armor that it doesn't really... It's great when you, if you get it like as your first or second item.
Which Dragon Knight is going for an AC as his Hyperstone and his Plate Mail, so that Desolator could be quickly null and void for the benefit of that Dragon Knight item.
It's still like what the alternative is, you get like a Scotty if you want some extra survivability.
Mm-hmm.
Go for another big damage item, like I mean, MKB, I guess, if you're worried about Heroes King Evasion. But
I mean, given that if he gets a hold of any of those supports, they're just going to be even more paper. I mean, you have barely 9 armor here on Mirana, but more or less the Shadow Shaman with only 5 armor base, like, they'll just fall apart so quick.
He could have considered Diffusals probably the one item. I think that may have been against the 2 Ghost Scepters of Tide and Shadow Shaman. Because the Shadow Shaman can always survive Dendi's BKB because of the Ghost Scepter.
Yeah. Well, for now, though, they're looking to tickle the high ground here as Dendi just kind of begins to unload his Fiery Arrow Fury from the low. Whoop, nope, not this time, PGG. Arrow going to catch in and not going to catch the mark. They do end up getting a hold of Tide. That is a huge takedown.
No
both
buyback.
Your Ravages, no buyback, out for a whole minute. That's huge. That's Rax.
I think he just bought that Ghost Scepter. That's where he spent his money, so he doesn't have buyback.
He has no gold whatsoever after being taken down. And
do they even go through?
That was such a nice
grab. I think Navi can just go straight. With AC, the damage is huge. They may just decide to play it safe, go bottom. Looks like...
Oh, and the Dragon Form going to be popped, thinking that Navi are going to go for bottom. They smoke up. They need to get something with this. And they're going to go on the hunt. They ping out where he is, but...
Dendi's Aegis still. Oh, no, his Aegis expired. That's why Navi...
They need something. The arrow right now, maybe they can get a dump. BKB can be popped as they do find Dendi. They scout him out with a sentry. Big damage, but Ghost Scepter going to be popped, and Dendi gets arrowed up. Slark jumps in. They do take down Dendi, and they inherit that nice dominating streak. Now making a move. Havos able to quickly finish off Shadow Shaman. Funnik as well on the retreat to get away from the rest of the squad, though. Moscow 5, relatively weak after that first engagement. Might need to second guess who they make move on. Oh, the TP going to be right out there as Funnik and Havos both make a getaway. So they lose their set of racks. They do take Dendi on the way out, but with a lot lost and a I mean, that was just perfect. Getting a hold of Tidehunter, bringing him out and bursting him down. Those two Ravages could have saved their racks.
Yeah, Tide's going to be much more careful with his position. As far as I think he thought he was maybe in fog or something there, but the flying vision from the Firefly and the fact that Funnik has a BKB, he can just go in, not worry about... the counter-initiation from a stun or a blink hex from another shaman and come up with those plays. And we just haven't seen M5 be able to use the double Ravage. They haven't used the Serpent Wards, which is level 16 now. Still hasn't got Ag Scepter. So Shadow Shaman's item progression has just disappeared over the last 15 minutes.
Very rough. PGG in the bottom lane trying to push it on forward. And he might get kidnapped, taken away. Bye, guys. Taken to the high ground and just manhandled. A little too overpass his leash right there. You know, without proper vision on where Navi exactly is, I think he got a bit overzealous. Yeah.
Incredibly cocky play from him. But at the same time, it's a very unimportant kill. It's not going to matter. Hey, he's going to be alive by the time Navi reach their base. He's the least farmed hero on their team, so he's not really lost anything from it. So it's a pretty meaningless kill. Thanks for a top in this hiding spot.
He's like scouting out on his post. They're going to come in from behind. Epi, they're going to go right for DK. Huge burst with the Mystic Flare and Burrow. He does get the BKB off as Tide's there. He's going to use both Ravages to go on two, but he also catches Dendi. They don't know it. They take down both because of those two Ravages. Now they're going to go ahead and press on forward with what they can. A buyback is available on Sand King if needed, but it's only a Skywrath and Sand King that go down.
No,
I don't
Epi
think that's going to be
that's
enough.
That's the other costly thing here.
Yeah. Maybe. I don't think they have enough to push in the base without those big ultimates.
Yeah. I mean, I was just saying how the Mirana kill didn't really matter, but the fact Mirana's not here right now for this high ground siege just to give some help with the arrows does make a little bit of a difference.
Oh, wow. Goes in with the wards, but Ghost Scepter's going to be popped, and that allows Dendi to just clean up the wards.
I'm stuck on a cliff here. He can't really clean down right now.
He's stuck up on the high ground. Moonlight Shadow is going to be popped with PGG's return, but Havos pressing on in, gets that Doom on Slark, and there's nothing he can do about it. Plus, the right click coming out from Dendi is more than enough. They dust, they go up. They hope that Tidehunter's still there, but he had already made his way out. But still, Navi defend very nicely, bring in more gold for themselves. They take down the Slark. Moscow 5 just kind of grasping at straws as far as what their all-or-nothing play can be, and they had a huge start to this one, taking out the mid-set of racks and going towards that top lane. But ever since then, man, that huge turnaround fight that Navi took control of, it's just been their game since.
I think that whole top fight was still okay-ish for Moscow 5. Like, they got 2 kills, they forced a Sanctum buyback, but lose the I guess Slark's the hero they most need items on right now. Like, get him an Abyssal Blade, the BKB, whatever it may be, but...
got a lot of farm, just needs to make the investment, but he has to constantly set that chunk of change aside for a reserve buyback.
Invisibility.
Yeah, proven to be hard.
Navi have just got so much money, their cores are always going to buy back right now. Denny and Avost are so well off. Funny, in a similar position where he's got 2.7k gold, may buy some boots of travel now, though, to join up with his team and go for a base break. Yeah, he buys the boots of travel and says, screw buyback.
Hail Mary Arrow Desperation might almost get Vance Korn. Nope, won't be there, but it's pretty much come to that. These Hail Mary plays coming out from Moscow 5 is this is the biggest, most dramatic lead of the game in Navi's favor, flirting around the 10k advancement. Man, oh man, it's just looking so good for them. And for Moscow 5, they really are banking on waiting out now for the double Ravage to get back in online, your Epicenter ready to go, your wards, and you're just hoping to take a fight in a position that you can really take advantage of, like inside the top of this base. But Navi are just doing good with their own positioning, keeping everyone back. They removed all the wards from their own side of the map, and now they're looking to go on the aggressive here as they begin to sweep through, taking the farm from the Moscow 5's jungle. They're putting aggressive wards down. Now they have the vision on their own side, and they're going to begin to corral Moscow 5 back into their own base.
Yeah. And, Lavos is ready mid with a Doom, but doesn't want to use it on anyone apart from the Tide, really. Actually, forced to pop his BKB here. Lavos in some trouble.
Pops Shivas, he's ready to man up, and man, he blows up DK. That level death, even at this late in the game, can still make a huge impact. And now, Tepo desperately pulls out his Ghost Scepter, not going to get anything. Dragonite's next on the list, going to get grabbed up there from Funnik, while Slark continues to make work here on Havos, but does he have enough to break through that big, big armor? A stun, very nice arrow right there from PGG, and that is enough to take down Havos. Now, of course, a very wealthy Havos who has plenty of gold for a buyback, but meanwhile, they also make a move on Denny. They catch him out as well. Nice turnaround for Moscow 5. They take down four at only the exchange of their Tide.
Buyback from the DK. DK died, but he was kind of the bait. Like, he tanked a lot of spells, held onto his ulti even, so he kind of knew he was going to die. Let himself get doomed, and then Tide could just go in with his Blink Ravage. Didn't even use a second Ravage.
They're hustling to the other side if they can to, oh no, it's Roche is up, but look who's lingering nearby.
I'm surprised they're not trying to force buybacks. I guess they have. They think they have. They have like a minute plus on the respawn timer, so they can go Roshan and then also try force the buybacks.
They have to know he's there. He just put down a napalm stack. Oh, he's gonna flame break and get a hold of this. Batrider is one of the best. They
better. They
might need to. They don't have a BKB to pop. Flame break.
Too easy.
Grabs it and leaves. That's just perfect Batrider execution. And you need to know that Batrider's up. You need to be scouting out with the arrow. Hell, you might even consider popping your BKB right as it dies just to make sure that flame break doesn't hit you, but
that's
just classic
so
Batrider. I mean, I would be like, oh my god, that's the biggest play I've seen, but I've seen it so many times now that
I wouldn't even consider that like an amazing play. Like, it was solid
just,
all-around play. It was
that's just what
bread
you do.
And butter, yeah.
That's one of the, I mean, now with this new Roche location, it makes it so much easier for a Batrider to even do that, and that's why people are still considering the advantage for Dire side going against the Roche just because of that alone, especially if you have a Batrider on your team. And well, props to Phonic on getting the job done, but
that was so terrible for Moscow 5 because Klinks and Doom were dead. M5 had the option to try force out two key buybacks by going for a push, but those heroes are respawning now, did not have to buy back. They stole the Aegis. Like, that went as bad as it possibly could have been. I have no idea.
They
why
are just
M5 top?
They are recklessly looking for someone to take down, and they go into FNG
good.
And I mean, what are they doing? They're getting so bloodthirsty for something. Now, they do find Skywrath Mage, but Havos moves in.
The two
carries out
buyback.
His ultimate.
That's the big problem here.
Yeah, even if they take them down once, they're going to have to battle through twice, and now they are on the risk of losing their Slark. Even under Moonlight Shadow, he goes down. Return Ravage. This might be the last hurrah here. They're expending so much wards in both Ravages to just desperately take down what they can. Now, they do get FNG, and Havos does end up falling. But he has buyback still available here. Now they turn their sights towards Funnik. Give us that Aegis,
okay.
You son of a gun! They do get a hold of him. Gem hits the deck.
He's got buyback too. So, good fight for Moscow 5 in the end. Navi just chased way too hard. I don't think Navi are going to lose here by any means. They've got buyback on Doom as well as Batrider. But they may lose his melee wrap.
They could very well. If this fight goes bad, it could get even a lot worse. Now they might consider making a move on Dendi. Well, it looks like they're making a focus. DK also might fall here. Dendi ends up going down, immediately buys back, who still has it available. But regardless, they take down DK, who's out for 113 seconds with no buyback on his side. And now they're pressing forward. They get a hold here. King R, Ghost Scepter, but it doesn't matter. His gem falls, Skywrath will just kind of swoop that on up. PGG moves in, can he get the level death off? Nope.
I I mean, Moscow 5 just, I mean, that's your typical PGG Russian Dota constant aggression. They went for a fight at top lane after Doom and Klinks had respawned. Both had, I guess they don't know when they have buyback, but there's a high chance those two carries have buyback. This is 40 minutes plus in the game. These heroes are going to have buyback, and they went for a 5-on-5 fight despite that, and it worked out.
They popped the Lincolns, and now Dendi just easily right-clicks him down, though he uses the cheese, but that cheese, though it may taste Gouda, it will be his last meal as the end of the game. Quickly taken apart, and now Slark out. 100 seconds, no buyback for him either.
Yeah. Looking for a kill in mid lane here. It's a TP in, and that's PGG dead.
Yeah,
so, what a very back and forth. This is being a game with some good
I'm actually surprised how much the gold graph went back up towards Moscow 5 because of that engagement.
It's the buybacks that were used.
But
it's changed a lot because it's now a net worth graph, not a gold graph. Yeah. So it actually reflects the buybacks being spent. The actual gold earn graph will be quite different. And they just go through. No buyback on Slark. DK has no buyback.
He's out for a minute and 30 more seconds before DK's up, and they're just going to press on in. It could be here. That AC, that Desolator.
Zero Ravages, 15 seconds.
Huge, huge damage. Tide, who already spent both of those Ravages, hops in. This is a desperate attempt now for Moscow 5 to pull out of defense, but Tide quickly falls. King R gets caught out with a lasso. His ward still trying to slow everyone down, but he ultimately will also fall. Two buybacks from both of them again, but this time they don't have their ultimates, and already they're thrown under huge pressure. There's the first Ravage that could come
connected,
out,
but not like in close proximity.
Not enough to stop Dendi here from unleashing his right-click fury onto the base, but now he's going to be focused down. DK pops his BKB, presses on forward, only gets Funnik. Funnik gets stunned out. Now Havos locked by the tower. Arrow's not going to catch with the follow-up from PGG, but they are able to right-click him down.
No,
Havos is out.
Dendi doesn't have buyback. He's still alive, luckily. If Dendi had died there, they just straight up lose, but we may see like a counter-throne attempt here. The fact
here we go, Moscow 5, the other way, man. They got to run all the way down to the other side to try to do as much damage as possible while Havos is dead.
But pressure too, so there's one Ravage at least.
One Ravage, no wards, however. A minute, though. I mean, it could take a minute to get there. That's 30 seconds of still Havos being dead where they'll have wards at the go. But look at this, Dendi, he might consider going in behind the back door. He's already creeping down towards the base, and look who's pushing in from the top.
Creep wave to get in and then
they're going
to
need someone to get back here. Slark, they have TPs at the ready.
God, this creep wave is in. This creep wave's in top lane. This throne's dead. I think
he's
TP
going
is coming
in. They need
Slark
to go now. They need to go now. Dendi,
though, it's huge.
It is.
Dendi gets abyssal.
No. Oh, he gets locked in place. BKB, but nope. There's enough right clicks there that they do get it again.
That was close. Dendi got abyssal. If Slark TP'd a second earlier, I think he kills Dendi fast enough to save the throne, and Dendi wouldn't have had buyback. But it was always gonna be tough.
That game was a bit uncomfortable, man. I mean, it was all over the place. Moscow 5 had a dominating start. I mean, they took down a set of racks way, way quick with their huge push siege. But then Navi came back, but then there was still two different opportunities for Moscow to take the game back. That was a hot mess.
Quite sloppy from both teams. I think Navi especially. Their first 20 minutes of the game was just like, what's this team
going to the jungle.
Doing?
He had a hard time. He got taken down from neutrals. Dendi got caught a lot in the mid lane from a couple of arrows. Yeah. And
Havos is taking so long before he got the blink. The blink on Havos was like what turned the game for Na'Vi. And you just got to think, like, what if he'd just gone for that right off the bat maybe? But yeah, it's Na'Vi get the win. That's end of the day what matters.
Yeah, and you know, it's not like they certainly needed it, but they want to feel a lot more comfortable. This puts up Na'Vi now to a 4-1 record here for the Summit 2 Europe, and that will leave Moscow 5 now down to a 3-5. Still in contention, would certainly like to bring in some extra wins to put themselves into, hopefully, tiebreaker situation. Now, that was just game number 2. We have 6 best of ones for you today on the schedule. Coming up next, we are going to have Team Empire taking on Compass Gaming. Should be an exciting one. If you like what you heard, catch me over on my Twitter, at CoddleGuy. The gentleman with me is Gods, of course. Welcome back, my friend. You can catch him on his Twitter, at BTSGods. A pleasure as always. We'll be back after a short break.